Hello, everyone. I'm Rajendra Roy, the Chief Curator of Film here at MoMA. So pleased to welcome you to this very special conversation. Before we dive in, I want to thank, of course, Chanel, our sponsor for everything here at Film at MoMA, and to all of you, our members, for joining us. We are here with the incredible team from Borat, subsequent Moviefilm, delivery of prestigious Bribe to American regime for make benefit once glorious nation of Kazakhstan. It's a pleasure to welcome Jason Woliner, Maria Bakalova, and Sacha Baron Cohen to the Museum of Modern Art, sort of. Welcome, guys. Thank you. And congratulations on an incredible week so far. It's only, I think, Thursday when we're taping this. So congratulations all on all the acclaim so far this week.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's really been a wild ride for all of you, I'm sure, with this picture from beginning to the end of this point, at least. But I wanted to kind of rewind. And Jason, maybe we could start with you as director of the film. I mean, I remember distinctly where I was when I saw the first chapter in the Borat cinematic story. I was one of those idiots literally rolling on the floor in a theater in Toronto when it had its premiere at the Toronto Film Festival.
And wow.
Yeah. I'm showing my age. I'm closer to the Sacha spectrum of things, but it like hit so perfectly. But it also, I was with a friend who got it in the same, it hit her in the same way it hit me, which was floor rolling level. But I also remember the shock and horror of many people who, for whom it did not hit in that particular manner. So Jason, I'm just wondering if you could share your recollections of seeing the first chapter of Borat, back in 2006.
Sure, I was living in New York, and working on a sketch comedy show for MTV. And I just remember that one weekend, it was the thing everyone was doing. It hit this kind of, boiling point where everyone you know was going to see it. And I think everyone remembers their experience being similar to how you described, just screaming with laughter. And also just this feeling of, you know, I was such a fan of Sacha's for years already because of the Ali G show and just knowing his work. But seeing something cross over from kind of, you know, comedy nerd world to this massive thing that it felt like everyone in America and the world was able to get and go crazy about. It was just an incredible thing to watch, and it was inspiring. And as I told him when we first met about this, I still consider it the funniest movie ever made. So that was my experience of the original.
I should point out that while this is your, I believe, first credited feature film as a director, you have a huge array of credits as a director, and the sketch comedy show, I think, was Human Giant. Was that the one you
were? Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So you bring a lot of experience to this, but wow, what a way to launch yourself as a feature film director. Maria, can you share with us your memories of seeing Borat for the first time and where and how that was?
I think my first time with Borat was quite recently, last year, 2 years ago. When I came to America for the first time, and I freaked out because it's genius. It's incredible.
She had the role, right?
Yes.
No. And
yes. They kept the project so confidential. So I wasn't sure, is it actually a movie like that exists before? And I did my research, and I knew that it's Borat, but I was kind of scared to see it, because the bar was super high, and Sacha is genius, he's master. And when I saw it, I was like, oh my God, am I gonna be able to stand right next to him? And am I gonna ruin the movie? But I had both of them, I had Sacha and Jason, who guided me from the very beginning. And Sacha was my mentor, Jason was my incredible director, and I was part of the second one.
So it's probably an understatement to say that this is your international breakthrough. I mean, it's like a supernova of well-deserved recognition for an truly remarkable depiction of Borat's daughter. But you're a Bulgarian actor, right? And was Borat released in Bulgaria 14 years ago? Or
it has been released, and I was checking on IMDb recently. how many people have seen it, and it's actually a huge amount of people watched it at the first week of release. I think it's something like that, that the week of release, something similar, the way that is the film term to say. And but I've been 9-10 years old, so I haven't seen it at the beginning. And even if I had seen it, I couldn't ever understood it. So now at this age, when I'm 24, when I was 22, 23, when I saw it for the first time, I understood it and I was like, wow, it's so brilliant how through comedy, through entertaining people, you might ask some really serious questions and to show some issues that probably we can do better. So it's, I'm honored that I'm, gotcha.
No, that's amazing. It's an amazing story. So Sacha, look, there must have been incredible pressure from fandom, if not other places, to revive this character cinematically. But few of us could have anticipated that if you ever chose to, which you obviously have, and thankfully, that part of the reasoning would be to take down what, you know, I described in the write-up of this film for MoMA as malignant masculinity, amongst other things, obviously, that are targeted. But that, for me, was the profound, oh my God, he nailed it again. And obviously, you had a great group of collaborators and co-writers on this. But that kind of skewing, that feminist skew, was what was so brilliantly engaging or captivating to me, at least, and the friends I was watching it with, including the same woman who I watched the first one with. Talk to us a little bit about taking that angle with the satire this time.
So, I mean, by the way, not everyone noticed that we felt that would be a theme, you know, and there were a lot of different, you know, a movie like this has got to operate in different levels. It has to work as a movie.
Sure.
We wanted it to be emotionally engaging, this, you know, story you actually care about these two characters, which I think is doubly hard because the audience are aware that myself and Maria are actors with real people.
Yeah.
But then they have to also care about us as characters and care that we're going to end up together. So there was that challenge. It also, we wanted it to work politically as a satire against Trump and Trumpism and everything that had made me and the rest of the writers and producers and Jason and every member of the crew very angry over years. So this was a work born out of anger. And then we thought, could this be a way to discuss the concept of patriarchy and the issues with it by showing somebody from the most patriarchal society ever, our fictional version of Kazakhstan, and then, you know, commenting on the fact that for, you know, huge sections of girls around the world, they are owned by their father until the day when they're owned by their husband. Yeah. And that's going on simultaneously with women running huge corporations and governmental institutions. And so we felt we wanted to investigate the misogyny within America and to slightly posit that theory that you could argue in some areas of America and with some aspects, women have the same rights that they do in certain third world countries in terms of what they can do with their body, what they can achieve, even the age of consent, stuff like that. So that was one of the theories we wanted to question, you know, the concept of patriarchy. I didn't want it to be just a bunch of male writers doing that. So we brought in Nina Pedrad, who is a fantastic Iranian comedy writer, who brought in that experience of actually her relationship with her own father. He taught us something really crucial, which is you love your dad no matter what views they have. And even though, you know, her father, and I don't want to speak out of turn, but had some of the exhibits of Borat, she was deeply in love with him. So this was the story of a girl who loves her dad, even though he treats her as an object and treats her as, you know, having a value below a horse. until she has this awakening. I mean, the amazing thing with Maria is she goes through this complete transformation of this incredibly primitive, almost animalistic, you know, person to a right-wing reporter who's believable enough to actually be brought in by the lead correspondent of One American News, OAN, Trump's favored channel, who brought her into the White House on the day that Donald Trump was there. So this incredible transformation. So we brought in Nina Pedrad, the brilliant Erica Rivenoya, and who, you know, worked on South Park and had written with Jason before on Last Man on Earth. And then we had a brilliant new comic called Jenna Friedman, who's a very satirical, very biting comic. And it was completely liberating. There were scenes in it as a result that we never would have had if it was just a bunch of guys, because we would have probably gone, wait a minute, a joke about a sketch about menstruation, we're not going to do that. That's going to be, we probably would have thought it was misogynistic, but it's really interesting that we had, you know, Jenna Friedman and Erica Rivenoy were going, no, you must do that. You must lean into the fact that women are made to feel ashamed of what is natural for them. You know, it's absurd. Why should they be ashamed of something that happens because they are human? You know, they are fundamentally, you know, fundamentally disadvantaged because of constraints put on them by men. And then obviously, and one of the great things Jenna did was she told us about these pregnancy crisis centers, where it wasn't just women are denied the right to choose what to do with their body. We posited the theory, if you brought in the worst case scenario of underage sex, you know, technically rape, and it's incestuous, what would the person in the pregnancy crisis center do? And what the, you know, that's the theory that we're testing out. And the guy there says, have the baby, it's God's will. So, you know, the other reason we wanted to talk about feminism and misogyny was we were very aware that this was a movie about Trump and Trumpism. And we felt, and we knew, and through, you know, listening to a lot of academics in it, we knew that women would change the election.
Yeah.
You know, white women, women of color in Georgia. And so to have, again, these were high ambitions. We were making this crazy movie. You know, when you're doing a movie like this, where you're asking people to risk their own safety and they might go to jail, they might get beaten up. You know, there were times where some of the crew could have even got shot. They have to be motivated by something. And we were all motivated by this disgust and anger.
Yeah.
And part of the core of Trumpism was this misogyny, which is why we had to do the scene of Maria and one of Trump's inner circle. We wanted to infiltrate Trump's inner circle and demonstrate in a very real way, visually, you know, the misogyny that exists within, which is the core of that movement.
Yeah. No,
even though there are female supporters.
No, I mean, which is that's a whole other chapter, and maybe we'll get that towards the end.
I gave a very long answer there. I wish I had time, but it felt like, felt like 6 minutes.
No, but
sorry, that's just my publicist telling me to keep it quiet.
Look, you know, you can't tackle Trumpism without tackling misogyny, but it feels like something that had been sidelined because of the racism, because of the anti-Semitism, because of go down the list of evils of Trumpism. But look, Tutar is the center of the film. And I thought that was the other incredible gesture, was moving the center of the film from Borat to Tutar and you know, everything that she embodies. And though she doesn't know her father going in, clearly the DNA of how this character is written and developed through the picture, she has all of his abilities to expose American hypocrisy and corruption, et cetera, but maybe with even more determination, right? And more ultimately kind of nuanced skill of infiltration. So Jason, maybe you could just outline that for us, of like how that character development, you know, progressed? Because I imagine you didn't shoot this, you know, in any kind of narrative order. And then how you and Maria and Sasha worked on implementing that.
You know, we actually did shoot a lot of it in narrative order, for the reasons you're talking about, in terms of developing the character and seeing, you know, what worked best and what didn't and what their dynamic was. And the only stuff we kind of didn't really shoot entirely out of order, some of what we called the horse box scenes, when they're at the horse trailer at night and we're tracking that relationship. We shot a lot of that towards the end because we, you know, we knew we'd have a better idea of what their dynamic was like and how they related to each other and be able to track that. But those scenes themselves, we did shoot in order. Sorry.
And COVID had happened. And the world had been shut down due to COVID.
COVID did impact that as well. But yeah, as you were saying, you know, Maria was so much more than we ever could have hoped. We found her in an audition, a self-taped audition in her attic among, I think, about 600 other auditions. And we had a feeling right away that she had something really special. We knew she was funny and, you know, compelling. And then we had to see, could she work in the real world? There's really no one else who does what Sasha does. And so to take someone new and train them to do that was, we didn't know if it would be possible. And of course she excelled at that. And then the final step was kind of a screen test, a chemistry test of the breakup scene. We did a version of when she rejects him in just a hotel ballroom in London. And Sasha and I both almost started crying, and we said, and we knew right there, wow, this is an incredible person who can do these scenes with real people. And as you were saying, reveal things in some ways in a way that Borat can't, because she's a young woman and she puts people at ease and feels so real in a different way than he does. And in some ways, what we were hoping was that it added a new element to this equation, that we weren't, you know, just repeating what people loved already, that we were bringing it to a new place. And certainly that's what Maria and Sasha together were able to do. And a lot of that was rehearsing, and then a lot of writing and trying to figure out what is their dynamic. Are they, you know, just kind of two clowns, or are they kind of this dynamic where they're both clowns in different ways, but he's the one kind of trying to exert authority, but he's, you know, kind of dumber than her in a lot of ways, that she's more primitive, that she's, you know, basically living in this barn. But in some ways, the difference is that her character is able to learn in a way that he isn't. So when she comes to America, we're tracking that development right away, where she's picking up things, she's absorbing things in a way Borat, we've never seen Borat do in that way. But of course, by the end of the story, he's also kind of progressed, and we've tracked that relationship. She's rejected him. And then in the time they're apart, through living with Jim and Jerry, these two real guys that we found that we were able to have him locked down with, he realizes that he loves her and he needs her and he misses her, and they come back together and they've both changed.
So Maria, look, I think part of what was essential that you were able to capture was her raw courage, right? But that, in a way, I'm supposing, must also have been something that you needed to find in yourself, was a kind of courage to go on this journey with Sasha and Jason. So maybe just talk to us a little bit about the balance between, you know, your own adventure with this and her adventure in discovering herself.
Sasha and Jason are super convincing, and they're so inspiring, because when you see them, when you listen to them, when you listen every single word that they're saying, it's just, I want to do it. It's so adrenalizing. And I'm like, oh my God, how can I live without doing this every single day? Who are we gonna meet today? What kind of interview we're doing? Which place we're going? And now when it's over, I'm missing it somehow. So probably I might have that kind of part in myself that I haven't found out before Borat. But I think there is a similar situation between me and Tuta, because me, similar to Tuta, I've been always dreaming about big, but never thought that it's possible to happen. And I think I've always had a courage to experiment and to risk, because even in the beginning, I wasn't even sure that this is a real casting, this is a real audition, but I was like, oh my God, I'm living only one life. Let's go there. I'm going to see London. And when I went there, I saw not only London, but I saw Sasha too, and Jason, and Anne Heise, and Dan Mazer, and the rest of the incredible team. So it's something, I don't know, it's something similar between me and Tuta, maybe, with the courage. And I don't know, I feel more alive when I'm living on the edge. I don't know.
That's, yeah, well, you
live. A lot of people are saying that we have to find the golden middle or something that way in Bulgarian. But I have a feeling that the more you risk, yeah, you might fall, but you might fall on a flat earth. So if you jump, you might start flying. Who knows?
And when you were introduced to and around these very public American figures, including the ex-president's ex-lawyer, who I think Sacha was referring to earlier in a now, I think, historically infamous scene, what were you just in your tutor box, or what was you, what did it feel like to be with these very public people?
When the scene starts, I think I'm more calmer. But before the scene, before every single scene, I was freaking out. Mm. And things got, Sasha advised me, okay, use this. That's how you're working. That's how your brain works, probably. You're gonna have some nerve price for a second and use it, because most of the moments Tuta also feel these emotions because she's never been there. She's never experienced something like that. So because of Sasha's mentoring and Jason's directing, it wasn't that crazy, or even if it was something that I loved at the end of the day. And yeah, it's just like one of the most beautiful memories, every single scene. So it's kind of nerve-wracking when you're meeting somebody that is super important and somebody that is on a really high position in the society. And you have to be even more convincing, because usually these people are extremely smart. When you're meeting lawyers, especially the lawyer of the president, there should not be a single moment when somebody can be like, is this a sketch? Is this an actor? Is this a joke? So maybe these things hasn't been a little bit harder, but you just have to do it. It's your duty as an actor. And I think it's something that Sasha has in his personality, that he makes revolution through his art.
Really? Well,
but think about her bravery, because you're dealing with someone like Giuliani, who we weren't aware at the time is still very powerful and very connected with police there. Mm-hmm. In fact, he brought a senior policeman with him as his security guard. He later was able to get the police to raid the hotel room, even though we had paid for the hotel room, and confiscate stuff there. We couldn't have any access to the cameras, so we had to shut down filming. I mean, you know, she infiltrated a very small event in Las Vegas with the former president of the United States. Separately, she met with the president's son. As I said, she, you know, infiltrated the White House itself, which had the added danger of it being a COVID hotspot at the time. It was 1 week before the super spreader event. So it's an incredible feat for any actor to do, right? She'd just come out of drama school.
Unreal.
She brought out of her country, first time ever in America. I think she'd barely been out of Bulgaria. And she's being given the most difficult job ever for an actor.
Yeah. Well, you, Maria, you've been rewarded with another historical milestone. I know you're the first Bulgarian actor to be nominated for a Globe and for now a SAG Award. And, you know, the list will continue. Sasha, I have to also, you know, commend you. You've had a lot of acclaim this year, not only for this, but also for your dramatic work. So let's acknowledge it with Trial of Chicago 7. But, you know, what has always inspired us who are your fans and your admirers is that you've leveraged that acclaim to amplify the outrages in contemporary America, which, you know, outrages in contemporary America or any period in American life, really, since World War II, have extended into the world at large. I just, you know, it bears noting that with your success has been the success in taking down tyrants. And, you know, I think Trump is only one of them. You know, if you can get Zuckerberg, then, you know, the world might actually shift on its axis in a better direction. But just one more like technical thing about shooting. I mean, it is a miracle. I mean, Sacha, all of your projects seem miraculous that they're actually able to be pulled off. But I'm just wondering, how nimble is the script? And Jason, as you're working together with the writers and shooting all of this, like, how much coverage do you actually have? Could you make a whole different version of this movie? Because I just imagine, like, given any certain scenario that you may have scripted, there's all this other stuff around it, especially when it's not just actors on set, that you're actually out in the public, that you're capturing all this stuff that is outside of the bounds of what you might have anticipated.
I think the answer, I think the answer to that is in the edit, there are hundreds of thousands of permutations of this movie. However, this one in particular is very tight in its script, in what we're aiming for in the script. Mm. And the script is almost identical to what you see on screen. So we obviously reinvented the script once COVID happened, because we were shut down. We, had this choice. Do we wait until COVID is over, which at that point people were suggesting would be a month, or do we go in and incorporate it into the story, which we did. However, the scripting process here is, I think, the most challenging one that I've ever had to do, and the other writers, in that essentially it has the structure of a rom-com and also the structure of a arranged marriage movie. So, it has, there are hints of Paper Moon, Monsoon Wedding, Wedding Banquet, Fiddler on the Roof, where you see a patriarchal family that's broken down. And there's always this common theme where this very patriarchal man becomes a feminist at the end, right? And that's what Borat has to be the most patriarchal man ever, who then is ready to risk his life because he loves his daughter and believes in her right to choose her own path. Yeah. So he rejects his own background, so the evidence of that is, before we shot any of this, we wrote a script and we thought, let's do a table read, which often happens nowadays, particularly for comedies. You want to hear the laughs. We realized that, none of the real people are cast, and they're not, we don't know what they're going to say. Let's write down what we hope they would say.
Wow.
And let's read it out for 90 minutes. We invited all the comedy directors, all the writers. We had Spike Jones, some brilliant, the best people we could get. The script killed. And everyone came up and they said, well, who are you going to cast for Mike Pence? Who are you going to cast for Giuliani? I said, no, we're going to get them. They're like, okay, you're completely crazy. You thanks for the opportunity, but you'll never make this.
Yeah.
So my point is that, yes, there are lots of permutations, but the beginning, end of each scene and the character development within each scene has to happen. At the plastic surgeon, for those of you who've seen the movie, Tutar finds out, there's lots of jokes, but she finds out that her dad is going to leave her. He's going to give her to Giuliani and then she'll never see him again. And she's gone along on this journey because she loves her dad. She wants to please her dad. She suddenly realizes she's going to be abandoned by him. And it's crucial that we had to hit that. Otherwise, the breakup is not going to work.
Right.
So the script itself follows pretty exactly what this would be if this was a romance, essentially. The race to the chapel at the end, which is Borat trying to get to Giuliani. Instead of putting the ring on her finger, it's Giuliani pulling whatever it was out of his pants. But we know that when rings are involved, it's over. So, I think the scripting on this was a lot more precise. We were completely targeted. We had no time to get this right because COVID shut us down for, 2.5 months. And we had to edit this in a complete rush. And so we knew afterwards, everything we did would have to hit. We knew that those scenes between Borat and Tutar would have to convey and chart their progression. Yeah. Of a father who's growing to love his daughter in a paternal way, and a daughter who is growing to reject her father. She essentially goes through puberty in 3 weeks in America. Yeah. You know, she goes through everything and then grows to an acceptance, and there's a new relationship at the end.
So Jason, just to wrap on that thought line, I mean, for example, like I've been thinking, like, I wonder if Mike Pence now is like, damn, I fucked up. I should have like gone off with Tudor, and I would never would have been like attempted murdered at the Capitol or whatever. You know, like what if there had been that kind of radical, like unexpected reaction to something in the script?
I mean, we were fairly certain that Mike Pence wouldn't stop his speech and accept Borat's daughter, Trump impersonator's daughter.
Again, you know, 2020 hindsight, right? Well, like, you could have had it all.
That's the element is that this is a very scripted story, and months are spent on structure and when this would happen and emotional moments. But then in a scene like that, exactly, you know, we go in with an idea of what's going to happen in the real world, and then you see what happens. So we knew he runs in. We imagine people will be yelling. So we set up 10 cameras on people who we think have good faces. And, oh, you know, I'm there at 6 a.m. looking at people coming in and saying, okay, sit next to that guy. You know, I'm texting the camera operator, sit next to that guy. I think he'll get really angry when we do this, and make sure you have a good angle on his face, and putting other operators on Pence and other parts where we think Sasha's going to run out. But even that, you know, it does, to what you were saying earlier, it requires an ability to be nimble. You know, we have this script, we know what we need out of each scene in terms of a story level, on an emotional level, on a satirical level, and then just jokes, tons and tons of jokes that the writers and Sasha come up with for every scene. And then once we're in the real world, it's just a matter of trying to kind of wrangle this chaotic environment in a way that it translates on screen, that we get everything that we intended when we came in, and that we also allow for the discovery of great improvised moments between Sasha and Maria, and new things that we find. And that also happened quite a bit as well. So it's a mixture of a very tight game plan, months of planning, but then the ability to kind of change on a dime or adjust to the realities as they pop up.
I mean, yeah, in terms of the improvisation, you know, something like the lockdown house, that's a, you know, 5-day scene. So you've got 60 hours of performance in there. We know that on screen it's going to be about 7 minutes. So we know what the 7 minutes we want are.
Yeah.
But great stuff may turn up in that, you know, 70 hours. So it's the looseness, but you know the beginning. You know the beginning of the scene, the end of the scene, and what we need emotionally, story-wise and character-wise for that scene to happen.
Yeah. And we also knew, for instance, in the lockdown house that, you know, no matter what happened in those days, we had to keep the reality to a certain level that we didn't lose Jim and Jerry, because remember, they were living with this person who they thought to be real. And we knew that we wanted to, them to find Tutar and wind up at that rally that we had already been planning. So it was a lot of kind of figuring out, is this going to be too far, but we, you know, or how far to push it, or how to kind of navigate that over those days. And that's every scene, is just kind of navigating, making sure that the reality stays real feeling.
Yeah. Well, look, you all have contributed, I think, in, you know, not insignificant ways to a slight shift, a turn of a corner, a glimmer of hope in the world. You know, the election has happened since the film was released, and the results were more positive than negative in many ways, but not, you know, certainly a cure for any of the ills that this country faces. I hope that the world doesn't need Borat and Tudor again. But if they were needed, well, first of all, Trump definitely seems like someone who would get along well with those two under like non-pressurized circumstances, right? And I could just imagine a whole like season of Borat and Tudor at Mar-a-Lago, right? Like, because, you know, basically they just blend right in with, you know, the crowd there, you know, and so, you know, Trump wouldn't even need his SAG card probably, since if it was kind of like a docu-series or whatever, but since he just gave up his SAG card. But would there ever be, would you ever consider, you know, having them rescue us all once again?
I mean, we'd recast Borat. I'm not doing it again. I think it's like the, you know, those crime movies where they set the, get the team together one last time and the head henchman ends up getting shot at the end. I think we were pretty lucky to get away with this one. We had, this was a lot more scary than anything we've ever done before. Singing the Wuhan flu at that gun rally, we came pretty close to it, people getting badly hurt.
Yeah.
And as I said, you know, hats off to Jason, Maria, and the crew, right? The, you're talking about cameramen who are out there really risking their lives. Just, you know, everyone involved, the editors who are editing 600 hours of material down to 90 minutes. Music done by this, I don't know where he's from, never heard of him, called Aaron Baron Cohen. And just, yeah, just we're very lucky that we have some of the best people in the world work with us. We had, you know, we got Mark Coulier, who's won 2 Oscars for prosthetics, to help build this, you know, great Trump mask. And we had literally, you know, the greatest people in the world helping us. They were on a mission. But yeah, I'm not pushing my luck again.
I hope we don't need them, but we're all so grateful that you came together, that Maria, that you made that video in your attic or wherever it was to audition, and can't wait to see where this all takes you. Rest up, enjoy the rest of this wacky season, and stay safe, and hope to see you at MoMA soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.